The title of our conversation this evening is Solutions to the Crisis in the Church and in the Family. And I hope this evening that we can talk a little bit about what that crisis might be. But more importantly, I want to talk about what the solutions to those crises are. And I would like to do that with some personal stories from our lives and from the history of the church, and also a few inspiring quotations from some of the great doctors of the church. And I'd also maybe at the end like to leave some time for some questions in case you have other things that you would like to talk about or ask about and maybe follow up on some of the things that you might hear this evening. And I'd like to begin to do that, first of all, with a story for all of you from my own life. I don't usually like to do that. In fact, I made a little resolution when I was a newly ordained priest that when I was preaching during the Holy Mass, I tried with great zeal never to use the first person singular in a homily, because I think people don't need to hear any meology. They need to hear theology, not meology. I've been a priest for almost 12 years, so there's a way to weave in some stories from one's own life or experiences from one's own priesthood with, I think, some discretion. But this isn't a homily. This is a talk. So I'm going to begin with a story from my own life. When I was a graduate student, I grew up in Colorado, and I was a graduate student. I went away to England to do some studies after my undergraduate years. And that was a very blessed experience for me, a privileged experience for me, in the beautiful and ancient medieval town of Oxford in England. And I showed up there to take up my studies, and of course, one of the first things I did was try to find a Catholic church. I wasn't a very good young man then, but I was still trying to practice the faith some. And so I found a Catholic church, which was very close to where I was living. And so I went to Mass that first Sunday that I was there in Oxford. And I sat down in the pews, and there was an organ in the back of the church. I wasn't accustomed to organ music in church, and I thought, boy, that's beautiful. And as the Mass unfolded, the organ was just unbelievably beautiful. It was a professional organist. The choir began to sing. It was a professional choir. The priest came out to celebrate the Mass wearing very, very beautiful old vestments. He began the Mass. It was the new Mass, the Mass of Vatican II, in Latin. And he preached extraordinarily well. And as this Mass was going on, I grew up in an ordinary parish in the suburbs of Denver. I had never been to Mass in Latin. I had heard almost no organ music. And the choir, when it was there, was mediocre at best. The vestments were ugly. The Mass was, as you'd expect, in English. And the preaching was unmemorable and sometimes not only not helpful, but probably destructive. So as this Mass, this first time I was at Mass in England, was going on, I was getting more and more angry as a young man about 22 or 23 years old. And my anger grew and grew. By the end of the Mass, I was furious because I thought, where has this been my whole Catholic life? The beauty of the sacred liturgy, the beauty of the traditions of our holy faith, the language of the church, inspiring preaching. Where has this been? I was furious. And in the back of my mind for some years, I was thinking about the religious life and the priesthood. And I decided that Sunday, I said, if I'm going to do this, and I wasn't still planning to do this, that is, become a priest or a religious, I said, if I'm going to do this, it has to be someplace where all of this matters. End of story. What happened, friends? What happened? What have we lost in Catholic life? over the last 60, 70 years? What have we lost? What happened? If you in this room right now are 50 years or older, I want you to just think for a moment, are there members of your immediate family who were baptized in our holy religion and who are no longer practicing the faith? Now, if you didn't answer positively to that and you're 50 years old or older, what about in your extended family? That is, cousins, nieces, nephews, or the lateral lines of your family. What happened? I think that if you're here tonight on a Thursday night, you probably care very deeply about some dimension of your holy faith. That's why you're here on a Thursday night. And you probably lament the fact that those people whom you know, baptized Catholics, are no longer practicing their faith, right? What happened? I think that we can trace that kind of a crisis, because if somebody who's baptized in our holy faith and is not receiving the sacraments, that is about the most critical thing that can happen on the face of the earth. Because you know as well as I do that the spiritual life, our immortal soul, is much more important than anything happens to our body. Might grow sick. Someone might die young. Someone might die tragically. Someone might lose a child or lose a grandchild. Someone might lose the ability to walk or see or hear. Someone might lose their memory. All of these things are natural evils. But if someone loses the state of grace, that is an eternal tragedy. And why? Because we are not meant for this world, right? God created us to know and love and serve him in this world and to be happy with him forever in the next. Why are we here? To get to heaven. Why are we here? To get to heaven. So if somebody has gotten off the train that is taking them to heaven, which is the life of grace in the Holy Catholic faith, the one true faith, this is a disaster, right? I think that we can root that to a number of things. I want to just highlight a few of them, and I don't want to spend a lot of time dwelling on the bad, because of course, no one wants to think about the bad. We want to look at what can we do to fix all of that. I think the mess began, well, it began in the Garden of Eden, right, with original sin. And we've been struggling since then to keep our act together. But we have everything we need to do that. We have all of the grace we need that comes from the sacraments of the church to keep our act together. If we're humble about that and persevering in that, if we're not afraid of the cross, if we're willing to just keep taking one step after another, even when we fall down, that all works marvelously well when we live in a society that is a Christian society, when we live in Christendom. We haven't lived in Christendom in the West for a good long time, but things really started to go south, at least in our country, in the middle of the last century. And especially those of you who are 50 years old and older know that very well. The Cultural Revolution was pretty catastrophic for our culture. And what happened there was that the world, which has always been trying to gobble up the souls of Christians, just got a lot more powerful in gobbling up the souls of Christians. So those people whom you know in your families who have left the faith, it's probably because, or left the practice of the faith, probably because the world has gobbled them up. The attractions of the world, money, or the lusts of the flesh, or the pride of life, the threefold concupiscence that St. John talks about in his first epistle, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. The world gobbles up Christians, and the devil loves that. He wants us to give it up, give up our faith. He wants people to just live for this world and to forget about their eternal soul, their immortal soul. So our culture really started to get pretty difficult for faithful Catholics to live in. And at the same time then, our holy institutions kind of followed suit. So if somebody in 1950 sent their children to the local parochial school, they were pretty confident that the children that went there would be taught by religious sisters and maybe religious priests, and that they would get an integral, full-bodied, thorough instruction in our holy Catholic faith at school. And the parents who were sending them there in 1950 also had that thoroughgoing, full-bodied, full instruction in the faith. They knew their catechism from first question to the last one. They would have been able to say, when I asked why are we here, they would have said to know, love, and serve God in this life and be happy with him forever in the next, which is the beginning of the Baltimore Catechism. So it all worked, and even if at home the parents were not so interested in, you know, following up about, now, little Susie or little Mary or Joseph, did you study your catechism? They knew that the sisters were going to take care of that. There was the backstop there. Well, by 1968, 69, 1970, 1971, 72, there were no more sisters teaching in the Catholic schools. And the one priest in each parish probably never had time to set foot in that school. The kids may not have ever seen a religious in a habit. And the people who were teaching them were just doing the best they could, but it was usually the moms from the parish whose children had grown up and gone off to college, because the school couldn't afford to pay any teachers, because the sisters cost almost nothing. So things started to kind of, the bottom of the catechetical instruction of the faithful started to fall out. The parents weren't interested really in being sure that the children were learning the faith, and the kids certainly weren't learning it at school, and haven't since probably the early 1960s. So what that means is that everybody from about 1960 into the mid-60s on doesn't know the first thing about our holy Catholic faith, to be honest. They don't know the first thing about why we're here. They don't know the need for sanctifying grace. They don't know the fact that sin takes it away from us. They don't know the power of the sacraments. They don't know the devotions of the church. They don't know any of it. And for the most part, no one has been hearing any of it preached from the pulpit on Sunday. So what that means is we have people who still can keep up the external appearances of being Roman Catholics, but they don't really know anything about what that means. So when the allures of the world for the college student start to really seem attractive, why wouldn't they go running after those things? They're very compelling, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life, money and power and pleasure. Why wouldn't they go after those things? There's a happiness there that they understand. That's the situation we're in right now. The church is about ready to go off a demographic cliff. This church and probably every other church in this diocese is kept open by people who are maybe 65 years and older, putting money in the collection plate on Sunday. Right, Father David? Yeah. And maybe even a little bit older, maybe about 70 years old and over. Pay to keep the heating going, the lights on, the roof on when you need a new roof. Well, those people aren't going to be putting money in the collection plate 10 years from now. Certainly 15 years from now, they're not going to be. And all of those families, maybe a third of whom, or maybe half of whom, or maybe two-thirds of whom are no longer practicing their faith, they're not going to be putting money in the collection plate because they're not here on Sunday. So we're about ready to go off this demographic cliff in the American church. And what are we going to do about it? Well, this church might close. Doesn't look like it. It's pretty thriving. That's great. But a lot of them will, and a lot of them are. The good news is that that's not the end of the world, because you and I don't need a building to worship God. We can do that right in our hearts. It helps to have a nice building to do that in, and it helps to have people to do that with. And we'll always find that. And I think maybe that's the place where now we can talk about some solutions. I've given you a kind of grim picture of some of the problems. And we haven't even talked about the family yet, but we can get there. That's more about the solutions. What can we do? Okay, so, well, if your family is, well, if you've got some people who are wayward in the family, or maybe you have young children, maybe you're under the age of 50 or under the age of 45 or 40 and you've got little children, I hope that you will look at that situation around you and say, no one is going to be able to be responsible for the formation, the Catholic formation of my children, except me. That mom and dad have to be the ones to teach the Catholic faith to their children. The Catholic school probably isn't going to do it. And except maybe with the exception of this parish, I hope, what they hear on Sunday probably isn't going to do it either. So it's going to have to be you. And really, that's where the solutions for all of us in whatever state in life we're in, the solution comes with each of us. So the good news, the very good news, the best news is that Jesus Christ gives us everything we need to be a saint. Everything we need to be a saint. The world desperately needs saints. And as we'll see in a moment, the church desperately needs priests and religious. But for all of us in this room, priests, religious, future priests and religious, and lay folks, the world desperately needs saints. The solution, the ultimate solution, and really what I want you to take away with you tonight, is that you are the solution to the problems that you see around you. Your holiness is the solution. Your cooperation with the love of God, the grace of the Holy Spirit working in your soul, this amazing life of the Holy Trinity that dwells within you because God loves you so much, he wants to come and make his abode within you. Your cooperation with that life, returning love for love, will change the world, I promise you. How does that look? First, it looks like a father of a family taking the responsibility over his family as the spiritual father, the representative of God, the Almighty Father, in his family, and saying, I am responsible for the eternal salvation of my wife and each of my children. And that means that I need to get down on my knees and pray for them, that I need to get to the church as often as I can to assist at the holy sacrifice of the Mass. Should I, God forbid, lose the state of grace, I need to get myself to confession as soon as I possibly can and get back in the state of grace so that I am a vessel of the Holy Spirit for my family. And if my children don't know their catechism, I'm going to teach them because it's my job. God has entrusted these children and this woman to me, and it's my job to get them to heaven. For the mother, who is the principle of love in the family that unites all of the other members of the family together, like the Holy Spirit does, she's the one who cooperates with her husband, and she is his heart. She brings the children to the Father. She mediates the instructions and the corrections of the Father to the children. She loves them with the same love that the Blessed Virgin Mary had in the heart of the Holy Family. She shows the children what it means to be a woman who prays. That is the church. That is the church at home. That is what builds up the mystical body of Christ, the kingdom of God. The solution has to begin in the family. And of course, our family's here tonight. And if you're here tonight, that's because you know what this looks like. You know how to do this. You know that you have to do this. That's one very powerful solution, is building up the life of grace in the family. And the other one, the other powerful solution, is then fostering vocations to the priesthood and the religious state. If the world desperately needs saints, and it does, the church desperately needs priests and consecrated religious. So, first I want to read you, now it's, of course, the computer is off. Can you make that start, Father Giovanni? I'm a post. He said, you don't let me use these anymore. I'm a postmodern priest, but okay, there we go. Okay, I want to read for you something, thank you. I'll let them talk tonight, too. You probably want to hear from them, too. How are we doing on time? Great. This is from St. Alphonsus. Does anybody know St. Alphonsus or have read any St. Alphonsus Liguori? He's nothing but pure consolation. Pure consolation. He writes beautifully about the Blessed Virgin Mary and the Rosary, the glories of Mary. He writes beautifully about the priesthood. I'm going to read for you something from the priesthood. Listen to what he says. The entire church cannot give to God as much honor nor obtain so many graces as a single priest by celebrating a single Mass. For the greatest honor that the whole church, without priests, could give to God would consist in offering to him in sacrifice the lives of all men. But of what value are the lives of all men compared with the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, which is a sacrifice of infinite value? What are all men before God but a little dust? As a drop of a bucket, as a little dust, they are but a mere nothing in his sight. All nations are before him as if they had no being at all. Thus, by the celebration of a single Mass in which he offers Jesus Christ himself in sacrifice, a priest gives greater honor to the Lord than if all men, by dying for God, offered to him the sacrifice of their lives. By a single Mass, he gives greater honor to God than all the angels and saints, along with the Blessed Virgin Mary, have given or shall give to him. For their worship cannot be of infinite value, like that which the priest, celebrating on the altar, offers to God. Moreover, in the Holy Mass, the priest offers to God an adequate thanksgiving for all the graces bestowed, even on the blessed in paradise. But such a thanksgiving, all the saints together are incapable of offering to him. Hence it is that on this account also, the priestly dignity is superior even to all celestial dignities. Do you see, my friends, how much the church needs that? How else can we have the grace we need when we have fallen down in sin? How else can we be nourished with this filling up of grace from the Holy Eucharist without a priest to do that for us? The best gift any family can give to the church is a priest. That's just one solution. Another solution is the consecrated state of religious men and women. Blessed Edith Stein, Saint Edith Stein, her religious name is Teresa Benedicta of the Cross. She was a 20th century. I don't know how many of you know St. Teresa Benedicta of the Cross. There she is over there. Wow. She was a Carmelite, which is why she's in this church, I think. Is there a relic of her over there too, Father? No, just the statue. She was killed in World War II because she was of Jewish descent, converted to the faith, entered the Carmel, and then was killed because she was a Jew in World War II. She said many beautiful things about the consecrated life, but she said that the rise and fall of nations is written on the hearts of contemplatives. And I read elsewhere, which I say often because it's so beautiful, I don't remember where I read this. The earth continues to go around the sun because of the prayers of sisters in their cloisters. That sounds like a beautiful image or a beautiful metaphor, but it's absolutely true. It's not a metaphor. And I'll give you an example of that. Our monastery, to kind of bring it back home, we're from St. Michael's Abbey in Southern California, which is the Norbertine order. That was an order founded by St. Norbert of Xanten in 1121, a very ancient order in the church. Maybe some of the frauders want to talk about this, or maybe you want to ask about this later. He had this amazing inspiration from God to reform the clergy, which was in a really horrible situation in that century, in the 12th century, not unlike some of the problems we have in the clergy now. He was given this great inspiration from God to restore to the church monastic priesthood that St. Augustine of Hippo wrote a rule for the church, for the priests of the church in the 4th century, after the model of the apostles. So what we live at St. Michael's Abbey is the apostolic priesthood. That is, priests living together in a monastery. We pray together 7 times a day. We eat together. We live together. And we do our priestly work together in a way of supporting one another so that we can try to be good and holy priests. This was the model that St. Augustine had for his priests in his diocese when he was the bishop there, and which St. Norbert then resurrected in France in the 12th century. Our monastery has had this kind of unbelievable success, we'll say, over the last 60 years. It's a refugee community from Hungary. Our mother house, St. Michael's Abbey in Chorna, Hungary, was founded in 1180 and shut down by the communists in the 50s. And 7 of those priests found their way to the New World, the free world, and they put down roots in Southern California. From those 7, we are now almost 90. We run 2 parishes, we run 2 schools. We say Mass in maybe 35 parishes on a Sunday in the area. The reason why all of that happens, we have 34 men studying for the priesthood, we have more vocations than we know what to do with, we're building a brand new monastery and a monastery church. God is really, really good to us, not because of us. In fact, despite us and our sins. He's good to us because there's a convent of cloistered Norbertine nuns 3 hours from us who are praying for us. That's why. We just try to do our best, but the sisters in their convent are the powerhouse of prayer behind us, and therefore behind you too. And I don't know that because of all of the critical things we talked about at the beginning of this conversation so far, or lecture so far, I don't know that we appreciate the value of contemplative life. And so it might not be so common for a family to encourage their daughter, have you ever thought about going to the cloister? Or to encourage their sons, have you thought about going to a monastery and become a priest in a monastery or a brother? But it's really true that the earth is going around the sun right now because there are people praying in monasteries and cloisters. So, and I think that's probably true if you think about it in a parish like this too. The great vitality in this parish is because you have the intercessory power of contemplative nuns behind you, St. Therese of Lisieux, St. Teresa Benedict of the Cross, and maybe also some women in cloisters that are living still. The happiest women I've ever known, ever, including mothers of families, including my own grandmother, who was a delightfully happy woman, the happiest women I've ever known or seen are the sisters behind the grill in the convent, without a doubt. They radiate a joy, and if you've never met a sister in a cloister convent, I highly, highly recommend that you go try to do that. Go talk to them. You'll see something that is like a little vision into heaven, the veil of heaven opened. Okay. I've talked enough for a while. I want to hand it over to my confrères and let them tell you maybe what's on their heart about your lives, about whatever you want to talk about. Frater Athanasius?
Come, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father. Father covered most everything. It just brought a couple things to my heart that I really wanted to hammer home, kind of add a little bit on top of his great presentation. The first thing is talking about, you know, his two solutions to the crisis in the church, namely that priests or fathers have to step up and be the man, the spiritual man, the spiritual father. The father is the domestic priest, we say. That means he is the intercessor, and he brings all of his family before God, and he protects them. When he is spiritually strong, the spiritual economy spreads out as a shield over his children. And following that is just that I can't tell you how many times I hear young children are very pious. They are naturally pious. It's a beautiful thing. And then they grow up and are corrupted from the culture, from the school. But I can't tell you how many times I hear of young children who see the joy in a priest, in a religious, and they say, I want to be like that when I grow up. And their parents, seeing the state of the church right now, discourage them. That's mind-blowing. It's mind-boggling. I can't fathom that. That is the greatest gift that a family could possibly have. It's really beyond. It's a grace. It's a vocation from God. He's calling your son, your daughter to a closer following with him, and the graces from that are untold and unseen, and sometimes seen. And finally, just briefly, the last thing that I wanted to say was that in the mystical body of Christ, there are many, many, many members, but one body. You know, many gifts, but the same Spirit. And that means that everybody's, you know, contribution, sacrifice, prayers are helping the entire body. But again, the consecrated life, the religious, the cloistered, is the heart of that body, giving life to the rest of it, so that the hands out in the rest of the world can bring Christ to the poor, to the homeless, to those in need spiritually and otherwise. And what greater gift is there than to be that heart, you know, animating the rest of the mystical body. So, and I just want to encourage any of the young men, young women out there to just trust God in that, because in my own life, you'll never know for sure that God is calling you to this, but he wants you to take that step. Once you start moving, then he'll guide you. It's kind of a leap of faith, if you will. And you'll never be happier. So that's all I really wanted to add. Father Ambrose did a great job, and I'm gonna pass it off to Father Giovanni now. Thank you.
Thank you, Frater. I just want to say one thing, and it's about something that I have no business talking about, and that's the Blessed Trinity. And I'm a novice, and this is going to be my very humble and meager attempt to, I think, summarize everything that we've heard about the beauty of the priesthood. And where we first see it, and that's in the Blessed Trinity. Who is the priest? Well, first I'll tell you what our Holy Father St. Norbert said. O priest, who are you? You are not yourself because you are God. You are not of yourself because you are the servant and minister of Christ. You are not your own because you are the spouse of the church. You are not yourself because you are the mediator between God and man. You are not from yourself, because you are nothing. What then are you? Nothing, and everything. Cardinal DiNardo famously said, or at least it's becoming famous because I keep telling everyone about it, but he said, he was asked, is there liturgy in heaven? It's a great question. Is there liturgy in heaven? And Cardinal DiNardo said in response, is there anything else? What else is there than the liturgy in heaven? We know that the angels are singing Sanctus, 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 that the Psalms chanted with celestial beauty beyond human comprehension are going back and forth, that constantly the eternal Father is being glorified by the heavenly court. That's liturgy. But what's the high point of that liturgy? And how does that happen here on earth? The high point of that heavenly liturgy is the essence of God himself, where the eternal Father, whose very essence it is to give himself, just as an earthly father, to give himself wholly and completely, and from that complete gift of his eternal self is the eternal Word, the second person of the Trinity, Jesus Christ. In that perfect gift of himself, eternally generated but not created, is Jesus Christ, the eternal Word, a real divine person. And that real divine person then, seeing the love of the Father, returns that love perfectly back as a son to his own Father. And from that love, the Holy Spirit proceeds. That's liturgy. What happens at this altar is the same thing. The priest, who is not himself, stands in the person of Jesus Christ, no longer as himself, in persona Christi, an alter Christus, another Christ. And he does the exact same thing that the eternal Word does in heaven. He gives Jesus Christ to the Father. He stands at the altar of God, and for the salvation of the entire world, he holds bread in his hands, and with a few words, the greatest miracle that the world could ever know happens. That bread becomes God. And he offers Jesus Christ back to his eternal Father as Jesus Christ. That's liturgy. That's the priesthood. And so when we hear something from St. Alphonsus like that, it all makes sense that the lives and the loves of every martyr and every saint are nothing in comparison to one holy mass. And I'm so blessed and privileged to be a part of an order who our entire life is the liturgy. We're just getting ready for heaven, and we love it. And so to any young man considering this, or to any young woman, or even to any parents, besides be a Norbertine, there's only one way, I believe, to find that path, and that is in the heart of Mary. Just as she taught her very son to walk and to love, though he is God himself, he chose to learn from her, which is remarkable. So she also wants to do for us. And that in this valley of tears, in this journey towards that heavenly liturgy, there will never be a single step in this journey where you are alone if you are with her. If you pray her holy rosary, if you consecrate your life, your soul, your mind, your body to her, there will never be a lonely moment, because she will always be with you. And she will reveal exactly what her son wants. And as our Lord said in John's Gospel, and your joy will be complete.
Hey, gentlemen. These guys are all right, huh? Yeah. we picked some good ones. You folks send us some good ones. Thank you. Great. So we have some practical, that's a really good bit of practical advice. It's always good to end a talk like this with some concrete things. You know, what can you do? Say the rosary every day. It's so easy. And I really highly recommend that you say it as a family. Make the sacrifice. Say the rosary as a family. It'll change your life. It'll change your family life. It'll change everything. Say the rosary every day and say it as a family. Go to confession often. And go to Mass as often as you can, not just on Sunday. So those are three very easy things. Say the rosary every day, go to confession frequently. You know, we usually say, we priests say, go to confession once a month at the minimum, or as quickly as you need to should you lose the state of grace through grave sin. And go to Mass as often as you can. The best thing, it's our window into heaven.